Hello, this is Jose Luis here at Parametric Cam, and welcome to another video in this series, Advanced Development in Grasshopper, where we're going to continue what we did in this previous video, where we implemented a counter that could count how many times the component had been updated, and it could do it by being triggered by a ticker, or it could do it by having a trigger ping the component over and over again at regular intervals. So what I would like to teach you in this exercise in this video is how to implement this idea, the idea that the component may update automatically at regular intervals, but instead of using an external trigger, how to do it internally from within the component. So I would like to teach you how to implement an auto update so that if I turn this on, the component is going to update every 50 milliseconds, every 500 milliseconds, every 1000 milliseconds, or whatever you set it to. And as soon as you turn this off, the component stops updating. It's actually very simple to do, and you're going to find this very useful, especially if you're creating components that do dynamic simulation, relaxation, video games, even in Grasshopper, whatever you do, okay? So let's take a look at how that would work. If you remember from the previous video, what we did was we have a counter component that every time I update externally with some new input, the number of updates, the count of updates goes by one. And I also could connect a trigger to have this automatically happen at regular intervals. So what I would like to do now is, instead of connecting this artificial trigger, if I want this kind of automatic updates, what I would like to do that is for the component itself to be able to handle that, all right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new component, which is going to be also a counter, but which is going to incorporate this auto-updating functionality in itself. So how am I going to do that? Well, I'm going to close Rhino and Grasshopper. And if you remember, we had this code from the previous video where we had basically the two inputs, the output, and then every time we computed the solver, we just took this global variable in the class, which was persistent, and we updated it by one unit, okay? But we depend on someone externally updating this component for this increment to happen. So what I've done is I've basically copy-pasted the same component. I have renamed it to counter with auto-update, all right? I have updated here the descriptions, the name, whatever. I made sure to change the global unique identifier because since I copy-pasted the file, the identifier is the same, and that gives me Grasshopper conflicts. So you make sure you update that to a new one. And then what I did was I added these two new inputs, auto update as a Boolean, so whether if I want to have an auto update or not, and the interval in milliseconds between updates. So 100 milliseconds, 200 milliseconds, et cetera, et cetera. And then the rest is the same. I hear though, I disclosing the solution here, sorry. Here, what I did was I added two variables. I fetched them from the inputs, but I haven't added any code yet, all right? So what this is going to look like is that if we wanted the component to handle auto-updating itself, that is something that we need to handle in the function that takes care of updating the component. So what we do in this function is we generate placeholder variables, we fetch the inputs, we do everything that we need to do to update the count of iterations, and we spit that out through the output. But then after that, what I would like to do is if the auto update flag is on, if the input requires that I keep auto updating, I would like to launch or to schedule or to make sure that I tell the Grasshopper document like, hey, you know what? I need to be re-updated in this many milliseconds. So the way to do that is actually quite simple. So here I'm going to write a schedule a new update if necessary. And we're going to start with an if statement, which is if auto update the input, if this was true, then what I would like to do is I would like to schedule a new update in this many milliseconds. The way to do that is first retrieving a copy of the document, the global Grasshopper document that owns the component that I'm in. I can do that by saying, for example, this onPing document. I could also probably retrieve the document object, but this is how I've seen it on internet. done more often. And then here I can access this this function that is called schedule a solution. And you can see that in the description you can say schedule a new solution after a specified time interval, etc., etc. The schedule is erased and a new solution is executed, etc., etc. Right? So what I can do here is I can pass here now the amount of milliseconds that I want to schedule this new solution for, all right? Which is also part of the input. Now, something that is important that I add here is also the fact that I can schedule a new solution in whatever milliseconds. But it turns out that if I do that just out of the box, because in the next solution, Grasshopper doesn't see anything that has changed, then Grasshopper will not flag this particular component to be triggered again, because since the inputs are the same, it sees no difference, and then it just continues without updating the component again. So what we need to do is we need to make sure that the solution is what is referred to as flagged as expired, which means that we basically force the Grasshopper document to believe that the solution that is currently on is not valid anymore and that things need to be recomputed. And that's why we need to add a call to make that happen. The way that works is that you can see that if I add another comma, I get the second overload of this function, which takes the delay, but it takes this thing called the Grasshopper document, Grasshopper schedule delegate as a callback. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but callbacks in computer programming are functions that are designed to be executed at a later time in the life of the program, kind of like multi-threading, kind of like starting a parallel process, so that whenever whatever you're executing ends up executing, like for example, scheduling the solution, whenever that ends, there is a function there ready to be executed whenever that happens. So what I can do here is I can add here a function that I would like to be executed whenever the new solution is scheduled, right? So whenever these 500 milliseconds happen, the new solution is scheduled, and at that point I would like to execute something before the solution is done. The way that works is that I can write here, because it's a callback, what I can do here is I can write a function that I want to execute. There's two ways to go about this. So what I can do is I can write a function somewhere else. So I can declare a function, for example, private void, and I'm going to call this a schedule callback, you know, something like that. And I'm going to look at the signature of this, and I'm going to look at the signature. Can I see the signature? I guess I can't see the signature. I wonder if this is something that we can look up. So let me actually look that up. So I'm going to go to the Grasshopper documentation, which I have somewhere, the Grasshopper SDK here, and I'm going to schedule callback. Grasshopper document schedule solution. Exactly. Where is this? No, schedule delegate, sorry. Schedule delegate. Nothing found. So what if I write delegate? let me find Grasshopper document. Let me look at the class. Let me look at the class and let's see if there's a delegate somewhere. Schedule delegate. And what is this schedule delegate here? Oh, it's in the kernel. All right, so this is what it is. So you can see that the Grasshopper schedule delegate, it's a delegate function, which means it's a function that can be passed as an argument to other functions. And we can see that here, and we can see that the signature of this function is that it has to return nothing, and that it has to take in a Grasshopper document that can be operated on. So what this means is that when I write this in my schedule callback needs to have the same signature as the delegate that we're targeting. What that means is that it needs to return void, but also the input needs to be Grasshopper document, and for example, call this doc. All right. And I'm going to close. I'm going to minimize this. I'm going to make this a little bigger. All right. And then what I can do here is I can say that the solution needs to be expired. What I want is to expire the solution. All right. Beautiful. So I'm not really using the document at all here, but I need to have it there so that the signature is the same. And now what I can do is I can just copy this here. All right. And then I effectively, this function becomes data that gets passed to this other one. And it's a function that will be executed whenever this solution, after whatever milliseconds, is scheduled. So let me see if that actually works. So let's see if that works. I'm going to open Rhino and Grasshopper. And I have here, I'm going to go here and I have this new one called counter auto-update. So I'm going to copy and paste these folks here. I'm going to add a button, an input button. I'm going to create a Boolean toggle. So if I want to auto-update yes or no, and how many milliseconds I want between updates, and I'm going to copy and paste this. So this component is working just as we had before. And if I copy the trigger, you can see that the trigger will also trigger this component just as we did before. All right. Now, but if I turn on the auto update, you can see that now every 1 second, the component is ticking itself and it's refreshing. And if I crank down the time, you can see that that update happens much faster. This is because the component is basically trapped in this loop where if the auto update is on, it schedules a solution, then it expires the solution. So it runs this code again. And because it runs this code again, it schedules a new solution. It expires the solution. It runs the code again, etc., etc. So it's kind of like, if you will, trapped in an infinite loop where each iteration happens at every millis, whatever that is. All right. And actually, it would be wise here to write like some kind of sanity check where you say if milliseconds is less than 5 milliseconds, then you stick to 5 milliseconds, because otherwise Grasshopper may actually explode. All right. All right. Beautiful. So we have this. It's working. It's auto updating. The only thing that I would like to wrap this video with is that I'm going to save this. I'm going to close Rhino, and I'm going to show you like a very common way of writing callbacks. Callbacks can be declared as an independent function, and then they can be passed as an argument like this. But it's actually very common to write callbacks as anonymous functions. Sometimes this is called delta functions, basically functions that are written inline that are not declared explicitly outside of there. So a very common way of doing this is, instead of having this declared explicitly, another way of writing this is saying, I'm going to schedule a solution at this many millis, but then the function that is going to be executed after that, I write it here directly using the lambda notation. What that means is that I can say that the function that I want you to execute is going to take something that I call the document, all right? And I'm going to use the arrow notation to signify that this is a function and that I need to execute whatever code is inside of brackets. And then there I can just copy paste the exact same thing and expire the solution. This is identical as writing the function outside and then just passing the name of the function. It's just that we're doing it inline. Some people prefer this kind of notation, sometimes people don't. This is good if you're only going to use it once. If you're going to be reusing this delegate in many other parts of your code, then it's probably good to just have it in one place, all right? And then this just executes, right? And I think it should be working just like it was working before. So you can see that now this is auto-updating, this is going up, et cetera, et cetera. And now it's auto-updating very fast. And there you go. And I can reset and I can accelerate that by multiple updates, etc. All right. Beautiful. So I think with this, this is what I wanted to cover in this video, auto updates. And actually, what I would like to do also now is make a more comprehensive example of this idea of auto updating for Grasshopper components that deal with simulations, like physics simulations, dynamic simulations, form finding simulations. So I believe in the next video, what I'm going to do is just a hands-on exercise, a practice, where we're going to take this idea and we're going to apply it to a dynamic simulation of particles moving and colliding and etc., etc. Okay? So thank you very much. I'll see you on the next video. And if you liked what you saw so far, and if you find it helpful, then maybe give us a thumbs up, like the video, subscribe to the channel, leave a comment, join Discord, ping me on WhatsApp, Twitter, Instagram, whatever you feel. Okay. Thank you very much and see you on the next video. Bye bye.